Gigabyte's Aero series laptops have been my go-to choice for a few years for people that do a mixture of content creation and gaming. So let's check out the differences in the new 2021 Aero 15 and see what improvements have been made. Thanks to Newegg for sponsoring this video. New Australian customers can get a $65 gift card when spending $650 or more on their first purchase. Despite living in Australia, I buy from Newegg in the US all the time as they've got such an extensive range of products. Whether it's laptops or PC parts, they're usually cheaper than buying locally even after taxes, which the Newegg site conveniently includes in their pricing. I've found Newegg's shipping to be fast and fairly priced, despite your tech coming from overseas. You can check out their offer with the sponsored link in the video description below. And now back to the Aero 15 review, updated pricing of which can also be found on Newegg with the links down in the description. My config has an 8-core Intel processor, NVIDIA RTX 3070 graphics, 32GB of memory and dual channel, and an OLED screen. The Aero 15 has a smooth matte black finish both on the lid and interior, with a subtle new pattern towards the bottom on the lid. Overall build quality feels great as it's mostly aluminum, and there aren't any sharp corners or edges, but these are plastic. The laptop alone weighs just over 2.2 kilos or 4.9 pounds, or around 3.2 kilos or 7 pounds with the 230 watt brick and cables. The new 2021 model has the same dimensions as last gen, so just 2 centimeters thick and fairly portable considering the specs inside. The Aero has a 15.6 inch 4K 60Hz AMOLED display, and like I've said in the past, this thing looks amazing. But there is also a 1080p high refresh rate option for gamers. It comes X-Rite Pantone calibrated with a delta E less than 1 out of the box, so quite accurate and with high color gamuts. It can get fairly bright too at over 400 nits, which we're expecting as it's certified for HDR 400. It's not possible to disable Optimus and there's no G-Sync, but it does have resizable bar.
There's no backlight bleed, as OLED panels don't use a backlight. Each pixel is individually lit. The 720p camera is under the screen, and there's no Windows Hello support.
So as the camera is down the bottom, it does kind of look up your nose a bit, and there's no adjusting it, but it does have that privacy filter. Here's what it sounds like to type on the keyboard, and this is what it sounds like if I set the fan to full speed. So it's not doing a great job of isolating my voice over the fan lines.
The keyboard has per-key RGB backlighting, which can be adjusted between two levels by holding the function key and pressing the spacebar. When you hold the function key, the keys that have a secondary function change to white. This works great if you've got the keyboard lighting off, but with the keyboard lit up, it can be harder to tell which keys have changed to white. Like previous Aero models, unfortunately secondary key functions are not illuminated. I really hope this is something they improve for the upcoming 11th gen version. Typing otherwise worked fine. The keys have a subtle clicky feel. Here's how typing sounds to give you an idea of what to expect. The power button is separate to the keyboard and above it in the center, and there appear to be some small air vents back there too. The precision touchpad is excellent. It's super smooth to the touch and works well. There's a fingerprint scanner in the top left corner, which I found to work fast and accurately. Fingerprints and dirt show up easily on the black finish, but they're easy to clean off the smooth surface with a microfiber cloth. On the left from the back, there's an air exhaust vent, HDMI 2.1 and mini DisplayPort 1.4 outputs, USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A port, 3.5mm audio combo jack, and a 2.5 gigabit Ethernet port. The right has two more USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A ports for three in total, a Type-C Thunderbolt 3 port, full-sized UHS 2 SD card slot, the power input, and there's an air exhaust vent on this side too. The Type-C port cannot be used to charge the laptop, and it connects to the Intel integrated graphics, but the HDMI and mini DisplayPort outputs connect directly to the NVIDIA discrete graphics. The Ethernet cable might get in the way if you're left-handed as it's towards the front. I guess there's not much space with the air exhausts on either side. Personally, I prefer bulky I/O out of the back and out of the way. There are two air exhausts on the back too, and unlike the old model, the Aero logo doesn't light up, which seems preferable from a battery life perspective. The front just has a groove for getting your finger in to open the lid. It's easy to open up with one finger as it feels well balanced, and it sits fine on my lap. Screen flex wasn't too bad, and the hinges felt sturdy, though the screen did have some wobble to it. Keyboard flex was on the lower side. The chassis felt quite solid. The Aero logo on the back lights up white. As the OLED panel doesn't have a backlight, it must have its own dedicated light. I didn't see an option for turning it off. Underneath, there are plenty of air vents towards the back half of the machine. Getting inside was very easy. Just take out 12 TR6 screws of same same length and pry off the bottom panel. Inside we've got the battery down the front, an M.2 slot to the left of the battery, and the other just above the battery on the right. The Wi-Fi 6 card is just above the M.2 drive, and the two memory slots are towards the center. The two speakers are on the left and right sides towards the front. I thought they sounded adequate, around average to perhaps a little above average. They were loud enough at max volume and still mostly clear without really any noticeable bass. And the latency mod results looked alright. This new 2021 Aero has a larger 99 watt hour battery compared to the 94 watt hour that it's had for the last few generations, a welcome improvement. I've tested it with keyboard lighting off, background apps disabled, and screen set to 50% brightness. It lasted for almost 7 hours in the YouTube playback test, and 2 hours exactly for the gaming test. So a good result for gaming, but not great compared to alternatives otherwise. But that said, it was lasting longer compared to the older 94 watt hour Aero models I've tested. The control center software also lets you set the maximum battery charge level between 60 and 100% to help improve the lifespan of the battery. Let's check out thermals next. The Gigabyte control center software lets you modify the CPU and GPU power limits. 2 levels for the GPU and 5 for the CPU. These can only be adjusted when plugged into power. They're grayed out on battery. Now, I found the 3070 in my Aero to run up to 105 watts in a GPU only workload with dynamic boost. However, when the CPU was also under load, the GPU maxed out at 75 watts. So a 30 watt range for dynamic boost. The software also offers different fan profiles, quiet, normal, and gaming modes. Plus, there's also a ton of granular fan control so you can get optimal performance. It's also possible to max out the fan speed by simply holding the function key and pressing escape, the key with the fan icon. The GPU is not overclocked, and undervolting did not appear possible. It was grayed out both in Intel XTU and throttle stop, and I couldn't see anywhere in the BIOS to allow it. Speaking of BIOS, there's not too much customization available here. The idle temperatures were on the warmer side when idling in my 21 degrees Celsius room. Stress tests were done with the Ada 64 CPU stress test with stress CPU only checked and the Heaven GPU benchmark run at the same time, while gaming was tested playing Watch Dogs 2. The CPU was thermal throttling at 90 degrees Celsius, which I think is fine. Gigabyte have had this limit on their Aero laptops for a while to prevent things getting too hot and running higher. Many other laptops will happily limit at 95 or even 100 degrees. It was possible to lower the temperatures quite a bit simply by setting the fan to max speed, and then using a cooling pad also offered nice gains as there's plenty of air vents underneath. These are the clock speeds for the same tests just shown. The GPU clock speed was the highest when both the CPU and GPU were set to the lowest amounts. And this is because Dynamic Boost is able to push the GPU higher in this workload. The CPU speed improves going from normal fan mode to max fan speed as this removes the thermal throttle at 90 degrees. When checking out the power limits, we can see that the CPU was able to run at its full 62 watt limit with the fan maxed out. An impressive result given many other laptops do not allow the processor to run this high in combined CPU plus GPU load. The trade-off, however, seems to be dynamic boost. When the CPU is using more, the GPU starts using less, at least for this workload. Here's how CPU-only performance looks in Cinebench with the GPU now idle. For some reason, the single-core scores were better with the lower power limit modes. Otherwise, multi-core scores improved as a result of higher TDP. I'm going to start moving over to the newer R23, as this is a much longer test and better shows sustained performance over time. The scores were better compared to the Clever-based XMG Pro 17 with the same processor, but not quite as good as the XMG Neo 15. Otherwise, all the 8-core Ryzen options were offering better multi-core performance with similar single-core scores. Here's how the Cinebench scores look when running on battery power. Compared to most other laptops, the Aero isn't doing great here. Both the single and multi-core scores are significantly lower when compared to similarly spec'd laptops. When idling, the keyboard was getting to the low 40s, warmer compared to most others I've tested that sit at 30, but not a problem in practice. With the stress tests running, it's at 50 in the middle now and warm to the touch. Normal fan mode was similar and hotter up the back, but you don't need to touch there anyway. Max fan speed was actually cooler on the keyboard than running it idle, and the WASD area was cold, but as you'll hear next, it's a fair bit louder now.
Unfortunately, my microphone wasn't connected properly for these tests, which means that you can't compare how the Aero sounds to my other video. You'll instead need to compare based on what the measurement tool is showing.
The fans were still audible when idling with the quiet fan profile. And remember, it was warmer here compared to most others. The quiet and normal profiles weren't too loud even with the heavy stress test running. Gaming mode was a little louder, then max fan was way louder.
Personally, I think this is a good thing, because you get a much more granular level of fan control, meaning that you should be able to find a noise level that works for you. And this is just much better compared to most other laptops that restrict you. Now let's find out how well the Aero 15 compares against other gaming laptops in games. But use these results as a rough guide only, as they were tested at different times with different drivers.
I've tested Battlefield 5 in campaign mode with ultra settings, and the Aero 15 is highlighted in red. This is a very impressive result. The average FPS is about the same as the XMG Neo 15 just below it, which has a higher wattage 3070, but Ryzen 7 5800H processor. The 1% low in particular is higher with the Intel-based Aero, which I think is interesting given the Aero can't disable Optimus while the Neo can. I believe this is because of resizable bar. I'm currently working on a video comparing gaming performance with it both on and off, so make sure you're subscribed for that one. The Aero moves down a few positions in Shadow of the Tomb Raider though. This test is more dependent on the GPU, which is likely why the higher wattage Neo 15 is now 8% ahead. Regardless, still a decent result from the Aero, and similar to many of the 2080 Super Max Q results, granted at the higher end of those machines that I've got data for. What I found most interesting was the Aero with these specs was 15% higher than the XMG Pro 17, the first laptop I've tested with 16GB RTX 3080 graphics. The unit I've tested has a similar power limit, so I would have thought that they would be closer together, but that wasn't the case. Far Cry 5 was also tested with the game's benchmark tool. The Aero 15 lowered a few more spots in this test. This is more of a processor heavy test in my experience, so other factors like CPU power limits will have more of an effect here. Again, it's close to many of the 2080 Super Max Q laptops, though on the lower side of these results now. What I found interesting here was that it's still outperforming the similar wattage 3080 in the XMG Pro 17 just below it with the same processor. So just goes to show that in some games, the difference between a 3070 and 3080 isn't going to be worth the extra price. It all comes down to the power limits.
I've also tested the Aero in 14 different games in this video over here, so check that one out if you want to get a better idea of how this laptop performs in games.
Now for the benchmarking tools. I've tested Heaven, Valley, and Superposition from Unigine, as well as Firestrike, TimeSpy, and Port Royal from 3DMark. Just pause the video if you want a detailed look at these results. Adobe Premiere was tested with the Puget Systems benchmark. They recently updated this test, so results are not comparable to my previous videos. And as a result, I've got less data to show. But out of the laptop selection I have tested, it's doing alright. Granted, performance is in between two 4800H plus 1660 Ti machines. Adobe Photoshop generally depends more on processor performance, and the i7 is in line with many other laptops with similar 8-core Intel processors. DaVinci Resolve is more GPU heavy, and the new RTX 3070 graphics is doing very well here, only behind the higher wattage 3070 in the XMG Neo 15. I've also tested SpecView Perf, which tests out various professional 3D workloads. I've used Crystal Diskmark to test the storage. The 1TB NVMe M.2 SSD was performing quite well. The UHS-II SD card slot was basically maxing out my V90 card when it came to read speed. However, writes were much lower comparatively. I don't think this is a huge deal though, as most people dump files onto the laptop rather than save to SD from the laptop. The SD card sticks out, so you'll have to be careful not to bump it. Finally, let's discuss price. You can check the links in the description for updated prices, as these will change over time. At the time of recording, the XC model with the same specs I've tested here is $2,200 US, while the maxed out version is more at $3,500. Here in Australia, we're looking at $3,600 Australian for the XC model, though this one has less memory, storage, and 144Hz screen instead.
Now, let's conclude by summarizing both the good and the bad to help you decide if the Aero 15 is worth considering. Overall, I think the Aero 15 is an excellent choice for content creators, mostly due to the calibrated OLED display, which I just love to work with. The high CPU power limits compared to most other laptops is also a plus, and despite the GPU lowering back in some workloads due to dynamic boost, overall performance was still pretty good. Seriously, Gigabyte, if you're listening, let me know if you want to swap this for my older Aero 15X. Well, actually, maybe hold off until the keyboard is fixed. Please just make all the secondary functions light up. The battery upgrade over the previous Aero was nice, though compared to other laptops, the battery life doesn't stack up too well. And the performance on battery was lower compared to most alternatives too. For content creators though, I think the OLED screen, SD card slot, and Thunderbolt are a hard combination to beat. And this is still what I would personally pick today if I was upgrading my older Aero 15X for content creation. I pretty much only use my laptop when I travel to make 4K videos. videos for this channel, and Gigabyte's Aero series is still the best laptop for that task that I've found so far. But I'm keen to hear what you think down in the comments, so let me know what you thought of the Aero 15. And if you're new to the channel, then make sure you get subscribed for future laptop reviews like this one.